Are you f***ing serious? Are you people joking right now, or is this actually the direction this Internet Bill of Rights crowd is trying to go with their pathetic and misguided excuse for a cause? Everyone who disagrees with us is a censorship lover, and if you persist, you're a legacy media crony. You know, I was willing to give the independent media creators the benefit of a doubt and assume that they didn't know about the government subsidizing social media companies or Operation Mockingbird, but the fact that they're so quickly resorting to such blatantly obvious attempts to divide and conquer through ideological tribalism is just f***ing disgusting. And Sargon, you can f*** right off. You are f***ing from a country which is currently being tyrannized by its government via the internet after instating exactly the policies which you are trying to get the United States government to instate into its laws. You know all those times you called out the British police on Twitter for threatening to arrest people who insult them? Yeah, you're on their side. You clearly don't have a principled stance in support of free speech, because here we are when it's time to actually put our money where our mouths are, and you are playing hook, line, and sinker into the government's power grab, even though it's been pointed out to you multiple f***ing times by hundreds of people that this is a power grab. You just love the taste of that shit on the bottom of those jackboots too much for you to let it go. Meanwhile, the so-called libertarian corporate bootlickers are actually doing something about this by trying to decentralize the internet. You know, actual political direct action which is going to accomplish something, that thing which you pretend you're doing. Have you people even f***ing read the bill you're supporting? The government is going to base their decisions on what is fair speech online off of the FCC's own subjective opinion, and you can be f***ing criminalized for violating this f***ing law! You people are actually supporting a law which can criminalize people for voicing their f***ing opinions on the internet! Wake the f*** up, start doing research for yourself, and start using a little common sense while you're at it. You're not gonna get rid of censorship on the internet by giving full control of the internet to an organization which is not only a monopoly, but enforces its monopoly with violence, and have it base what it allows on its platform to be even more vague than most social media policies. That monopoly, which you're begging to take full control, caused this mess by intervening to begin with. All you're doing right now is bowing on your knees to your new censors. And unlike the last ones, these censors will come kidnap you and throw you in a cage if they arbitrarily deem something you said to be unfair. Good luck with your liberalist town hall events in America if this law becomes a thing, before us crypto-anarchists can decentralize the internet, Sargon. Cause after all, I'm sure that the American police will in no way have any issues with someone who says something like this on social media.
You are acting like a bunch of niggers, just so you know. You act like white niggers.
Cause Sargon, you're gonna f***ing need it. Anyway, Filthy is gonna explain what we're doing, how it'll change the internet, and what's wrong with the Internet Bill of Rights. Enjoy.
Thank you for that wonderful introduction, Esso. Oh hi, I'm the Heretic. This is a follow-up to Esso's video, replying to the banning of Alex Jones and the Internet Bill of Rights. Link in the description. Before we can think about solutions, we first have to identify the problem. This started on August 5th and 6th, 2018. Apple removed 5 of Alex Jones and InfoWars' 6 podcasts from their site. Facebook then deleted 4 of Alex Jones' pages, including his own account. YouTube deleted Alex Jones' channel, while Spotify removed his podcasts on their platform. Even LinkedIn removed InfoWars' company page from their website for some reason. So how do these tech titans justify deplatforming Alex Jones?
Upon review, we have taken it down for glorifying violence, which violates our graphic violence policy, and using dehumanizing language to describe people who are transgender, Muslims, and immigrants, which violates our hate speech policies. Spotify can confirm it has removed specific episodes of the Alex Jones Show podcast for violating our hate content policy. Apple does not tolerate free speech, and we have clear guidelines that creators and developers must follow to ensure we provide a safe environment for all of our users.
Okay, we get it. The Alex Jones Show was banned for hate speech. Hate speech being vaguely defined on purpose as to give reasons for banning prominent voices that fail to conform to the increasingly narrow Overton window enforced by media companies appointing themselves the arbiters of acceptable opinion. Whether you're an Alex Jones fan or not, he has the right to say it by virtue of his self-ownership. People who wish to have their voices heard on major media platforms should pay attention. If you become a thorn in their side, especially politically, they will ban you from their sites for whatever reason they wish, justifying the ban for hate speech. Now, a common refrain would be that they're private companies. The website is their property, and they're justified in banning people for whatever reason they wish. This makes a lot of sense. After all, the right to free association means the right to disassociate, especially if the relationship is damaging. People want to treat them as private companies. As such, Sargon of Akkad, Styx Hexenhammer 666, and Paul Joseph Watson have all come out in support of an Internet Bill of Rights.
I mean, it just looks like we need to invoke antitrust laws for social media platforms and banning. I hear people talking about a Bill of Digital Rights, and I think that's a fantastic idea because it looks like some kind of digital antitrust law is going to be required if social media platforms are just going to cooperate with each other just because they can.
We need congressional action now. We need a digital Bill of Rights. We need new laws that block big tech monopolies from discriminating against people based on their political opinion.
Just pass an Internet Bill of Rights, though. Problem solved.
The original Bill of Rights was proposed as 12 constitutional amendments to the U.S. Constitution. It attempted to limit the ability of the United States government to infringe on people's rights through legislation. The Internet Bill of Rights is intended to stop social media companies from doing something similar. The argument goes that these internet companies are such large, influential spaces, they should be treated as public spaces, and therefore, users shouldn't be shut down or otherwise be discriminated against. This is where the Internet Bill of Rights comes in, a document that would prevent these companies from engaging in such arbitrary bans of users. This is going off of what Styx Hexenhammer has said about the subject as, to the best of my knowledge, he's elaborated the most on what an Internet Bill of Rights would mean. Problem is that he doesn't know the full implications of what he's asking for.
You don't need direct government regulation. You simply need a Bill of Rights.
So the Internet Bill of Rights would be voluntary? How does Styx planning on getting YouTube, Facebook, and Spotify to agree? He's not going to alter their terms of service by asking politely, unfortunately. Popular campaign? If you can really gather that much support that YouTube and Facebook would notice, which, let's be clear, will have to be millions of people, then you don't need them to listen. Just send them to BitChute, Minds, or Gab, any number of these alt-media competitors. But even if you did all that, and they were willing to listen, how would, say, Facebook comply? Will it be in their terms of service that if they are being unfairly discriminatory towards their users, they're liable? Liable for what? According to whom? The users? It won't be long before social justice warriors abuse that system to make a web platform financially liable for unfairly allowing people they don't like to speak. What should their response be, and what happens if they fail to respond? An Internet Bill of Rights that expects voluntary cooperation from social media giants is completely unenforceable and a total waste of our time. The only way you can have an enforcement mechanism is through state power.
They should be bound by an Internet Bill of Rights, and the normal judicial process should be employed. Not congressional oversight, not the FEC gets involved, no. The regular court system should get involved if there are violations.
There is no regular court system. There's civil court, criminal court, and family court. But we can assume family courts wouldn't see these cases. We can rule out civil courts as well, as no judge or lawyer would ever waste their time adjudicating every case where people subjectively felt unfairly treated by some media company, leaving only criminal courts. Requiring legislation passed by Congress, or even regulatory fiat written by the FCC for such regulations to have the force of law. Now let's be clear what will happen. To stop social media companies from discriminating, a voluntary agreement is not practical. An internet bill of rights on nominally private firms will necessarily require regulation. To prevent social media organizations from unfairly discriminating against people based on their political affiliations and ensure fairness, the priesthood of statism will decide what social media organization, unfairly discriminating, political affiliation, or fairness mean, and they will do so to their own political advantage. Since it is impossible to monitor all of social media and its content creators, even with algorithms, bureaucrats will have to arbitrarily determine what unfair discrimination is, who's doing it, and when, and you can be sure it will be selectively enforced. Make no mistake, the vague language of the Internet Bill of Rights guarantees that it will be used as a vehicle for censorship in the name of stopping fake news and Marussia. Once the Internet Bill of Rights starts becoming policy, what form it will take will be entirely out of Stick's hands and will not resemble anything he might have had in mind. A document circulating among Senate Democrats, written by priest of statism Matt Warner, includes the following. Mandating users disclose geographic information and personal identity at risk of criminal penalties. Labeling bots. Regulating apps as essential, which is de facto nationalization. The provider being required to offer it at non-discriminatory terms, and what that means will be defined by the state. Tech companies must also turn over internal data, which will include user data, to independent public interest researchers who are completely honest, trustworthy, and will never be hacked by criminals, we promise. This memo is justified by the US government's attempt to stop Russian misinformation and fake news. Odd how this memo was made 1 week before Alex Jones's bannings, almost like this memo was a threat. Speaking of the Senate, Chris Murphy wants to know if more websites he disagrees with will be censored. The survival of their democracy depends on it. If InfoWars and WikiLeaks threaten your democracy, then your democracy must be fragile indeed. The question of the Internet Bill of Rights hinges on Facebook, Google, and Apple being private companies and therefore operating in a free market and independent of government control. These threats and demands by the priesthood of statism should provide doubt as to that, but there's more. These companies are protected from liability if any illegal activity that could possibly take place occurs on their web domains. You can't sue Facebook for hosting someone who's doxed you, for example, because they're a common carrier under the Communications Decency Act. This creates a double standard where content producers like CNN or InfoWars can be sued for defamatory content or illegal activity on their platform. As if the competitive advantage that they enjoy isn't bad enough, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, Apple, and Amazon were awarded a total of about $2 billion in subsidies in the last decade. The subsidies come mostly in the form of property tax breaks, which, although they shouldn't have to pay those taxes in the first place, give these businesses a huge competitive advantage. Is Amazon not involved, you might be asking? Well, they removed the Amazon's Choice label from the InfoWars supplements on their website. Microsoft also owns LinkedIn, and they recently threatened to stop hosting Gab if they didn't delete two posts that were posted on their website. Other forms of subsidies can include Microsoft's contract for $19.4 million with Immigration and Customs Enforcement, and Google attempting to get a project called Maven to weaponize AI, a contract that could have been worth billions on its own. Between all the money that you, dear viewer, are forced to pay for your own censorship, they also have the huge competitive advantages against alternate media platforms in legal immunity. Make no mistake. He who pays the piper calls the tune. Apple, Facebook, Microsoft, they're all government proxies. The reason the big tech companies won't agree voluntarily to an Internet Bill of Rights is because they don't exist in a free market. They get money from the government no matter what their customers say. We all agree the banning of Alex Jones was unjustified. We're all clear on that. The banning, however, was done by government proxies within hours of each other, almost as if it were a deliberate and coordinated action to not only remove a dissenting voice warning people about the deep state just in time for the midterm elections, but to manipulate conservatives and libertarians into embracing legislative action that can only result in direct government control over the internet. Sargon, Paul Joseph Watson, Styx, all fell for it. Hook, line, and sinker.
We need congressional action now.
Congressional action. Congressional action.
Congressional action.
So the Internet Bill of Rights cannot work. What other solutions are there? People have suggested using antitrust laws to bust up large social media companies, but beyond the obvious problems of using government force, if the Microsoft antitrust suit is any indication, it'll take years to resolve, and by the time there's a resolution, the market will have already innovated a solution. Repealing the Communications Decency Act and removing all government welfare and contracts with these social media companies eliminates their competitive advantage against other media companies. Defund big tech, I say. But let's be honest here, it's a temporary measure, unfortunately. It'll only be a matter of time until the crony corporatists lobby for special favors again. If it's not Facebook, it'll be someone else. And until we can achieve a voluntary society, here's what we can do right now. What we really want is an internet completely immune to government censorship, where big tech isn't selling our data to advertisers. Such things should be completely impossible by the internet's own design. What I'm proposing is that if Cody Wilson and Defense Distributed can innovate gun control out of existence and make it completely unenforceable, we can innovate censorship from existence. Now, how do we do this? It begins by replacing the traditional ISP model of internet access with mesh networking. Rather than all devices connect to a modem, which connects to a data center, which connects to the internet, every internet-capable device connects wirelessly to a node, which connects to as many other nodes as they possibly can, dynamically and non-hierarchically to relay data packets. It can be its own network separate from the internet. Though a mesh network can connect to the internet, its internal network infrastructure is completely invisible to the government. An example of this in action is StreetNet, or SNET, a mesh network in Cuba built by tech-savvy young people. With it, they can chat with each other, play games through a wireless network. It's completely illegal due to China's ban on unsanctioned Wi-Fi networks, and there's not a damn thing the Cuban government can do about it. Another thing, Hypertext Transfer Protocol is 27 years old, and despite revisions in HTTP 2.0 in 2015, it's still running on an insecure and obsolete networking protocol. What we need is a new internet protocol, one that makes use of peer-to-peer networking and blockchain technology to encrypt absolutely everything, from text messages to opening web pages. True, anonymous web browsing. Even if the government did conduct surveillance on our meshnet, it would be impossible for them to tell who is doing what and where, making information gathering completely impossible beyond what people post publicly, making censorship utterly unenforceable. We can have free speech without needing permission. We will make everybody their own internet service provider. This is inevitable, and there's not a damn thing the state can do to stop us. Of course, the meshnet is imperfect. Nobody denies that, but we'll find solutions. The holy grail of a free and voluntary society is an encrypted internet. So if you're a network engineer, I want your help to make our vision a reality. Hit me up on Twitter, or hit Esso up on Gab. And even if you aren't a network engineer, you still have a crucial role to play. You can spread the word by sharing my and Esso's videos around. We are calling our project FreedomNet. I have put a link to the FreedomNet Discord in the description below. Come check it out and say hi. Look, I know Sargon and Styx aren't bad people. We agree the censoring of Alex Jones was unjustified and want it to not happen in the future. And if the banning wasn't coordinated, then it definitely looks like it was. But the Internet Bill of Rights is not the way to do it. Its vague language will assure government censorship. That's even assuming the legislation, once so written by Congress or the FCC, will resemble anything Styx called for in the first place. We don't need the government's permission to have a free and open internet. Cody Wilson is showing us the way, and I need your help to build the internet we all deserve. Tyranny needs lies to maintain their house of cards. George Orwell called it doublespeak. Lies like, you need a government that violates your property rights to protect your property rights. Lies like, an orderly, lawful society can only be achieved with government. That only governments can lay down a long, flat thing, defend people from criminals, or teach our hatchlings. Lies like the Emperor is wearing the most magnificent, resplendent robes in existence. While not everyone has the courage to, only with free speech can one speak the truth, that the Emperor has no clothes. And you can be damn sure they'll call that hate speech. We shouldn't be begging for permission from a coercive monopoly to speak. We must secure our rights for themselves. Support FreedomNet. Support our vision of a free, encrypted, anonymous internet. One other thing, if social media's goal was to silence Alex Jones, well, 5.6 million new people have signed up for his newsletter 48 hours after the YouTube ban, so it's backfired spectacularly, like all government programs. Questions, comments, critique? What do you think of Alex Jones's content? What are your thoughts on my and Essa's new project, FreedomNet? Please share this video around and get the word out about FreedomNet. Support me through Patreon and Ko-Fi. Like, share, and subscribe to become a heretic today.